HarperCollins presents In Too Deep by Simon McCleave. Read by Alice White. Anglesey. There is a word in Welsh that has no exact translation into English. Hiraeth. It is best defined as the bond you feel with a place, a mixture of pride, homesickness, and a determination to return. Most people that have visited Anglesey leave with an understanding of Hiraeth. Prologue. Castell Aberlleiniog, Isle of Anglesey, North Wales, November 1999. Midnight. A haze of moonlight cast a silvery hue upon the steep grassy hilltop that gazed vigilantly over the Menai Strait to the southeastern tip of Anglesey. It had once been home to an imposing medieval castle. On the far side of the summit, a freshly dug grave that had just been refilled with earth, patted flat, then hidden with branches and an array of gold, red and lemon-coloured autumnal leaves. A body had been placed into that earth with a suitable degree of care and reverence 15 minutes earlier. The salty night air was getting icy, and the man could feel the cold sweat on his brow and on his back as he put down the spade. Its wooden handle had rubbed the skin on his palms and they were now sore. It had been a long time since he'd done this much manual work. The grave might have been relatively shallow, but digging it was strenuous work. A woman stood nearby, holding a large torch to illuminate his grisly work. She looked around as her anxiety grew. The man wiped his brow with his cuff. "What do you think?" "I think it's done," she replied hastily. "I think we should go." For a moment, they both gazed at where the body lay and wondered about the repercussions of what they'd done and the ramifications of its possible discovery. The rhythmic hoot of an owl high in a nearby tree broke the silence and added to the tense, ominous atmosphere. Around them, the broken grey stones of castle battlements were spread out in the darkness, where the mighty Castell Aberlleiniog had once stood. On the far side was the base of a broad rampart, fractured parapets, and the crumbled outlines of circular towers. The timber and earth of the original Motte-and-Bailey Norman castle had vanished centuries ago, but the stone fortifications only dated back to the 16th century. The very earth of this place was full of dark stories that went back over 1,000 years to the siege of 1094, where over 100 Norman soldiers had died defending the battlements from the Earl of Chester. These days, the place was overgrown, neglected and forgotten. Giving the grave a final ceremonial scatter of leaves, the man was satisfied it was now adequately camouflaged. He met the woman's eyes with a look of solemn trepidation that reflected his fear. It didn't matter that this was a crime of necessity, not malice. "Okay, we should get going," he said quietly, as he leaned down, grabbed the spade from the ground and pointed to the footpath that led down to where they'd parked the car. "What if no one finds him?" the woman asked. The man raised an eyebrow. "Don't worry, they will." That was the perverse irony of their crime. They wanted someone to discover the shallow grave. In fact, they needed their malevolence to be uncovered. And the sooner, the better. Chapter 1. Beaumaris, Anglesey, September 2021. Detective Inspector Laura Hart looked up from where she'd just thrown herself to the ground. The skin on her hands and knees was grazed and bleeding. What the hell just happened? Dizzy, trying to piece everything together, she sat up, adjusted her Kevlar bulletproof vest and shook her head to clear it. Jesus. She knew it was August 2018. She knew she was part of a police operation at the Brannings warehouse in West Manchester. There was something else that was making her feel sick with anxiety. And then it came to her. Oh my God. Sam. PC Sam Hart, her husband, was being held captive by a drugs gang inside the disused warehouse that loomed over her. "I've got to get him out of there. The place is rigged with explosives and covered in petrol," she thought as fear overwhelmed her. A burly-looking firearms officer reached down and helped pull her to her feet. He looked at her with his blackened face. "Don't worry, he gasped, his throat raw from the fumes. I'm going back in. I'll get him out. She looked at the officer and his confident, reassuring expression. She trusted he would do exactly what he'd promised. Suddenly, without warning, the air shredded with a thunderous noise. The windows along the front of the warehouse exploded in a torrent of bright orange fire and a hail of glass. For a split second, Laura watched in horror as the entire building erupted and shook, before the force picked her up and hurled her backwards through the air. Then a terrible, long silence. No. Please, God, no. Sam was in there. He couldn't have survived that. Blinking open her eyes with a start, Laura fully expected to see the burning shell of the Brannings warehouse above her. She gasped a panicky breath. Where the hell am I? Instead, she saw a dimly lit bedroom. Her bedroom. The chrome bedside reading light had been left on, and a copy of Richard Osman's The Thursday Murder Club was open on top of the smoothed-out duvet that covered her from the waist upwards. With her pulse still racing from her nightmare, she took a long, deep breath. She reached over and took a sip of water. Jesus, my chest feels tight, she thought as she blew out her cheeks. It had been over 3 years since that horrific day in Manchester. The day that Sam had been so cruelly taken away from her. Laura had managed to rebuild her life close to the picturesque town of Beaumaris on the Isle of Anglesey, just off the North Wales coast, the place where she was born and grew up. Her children, Rosie, 18 years old, and Jake, 11 years old, had mixed feelings about the move. If Rosie described Beaumaris as provincial and boring one more time, Laura thought she'd scream. But Rosie was in her final year at school and was looking at universities. The promise of 3 years in Leeds, Cardiff, or even London had eased some of Rosie's grouchiness. Like his late father, Jake was an ardent Manchester United fan, so the move away meant trips to Old Trafford were virtually impossible. However, the slower pace of island life, the beach, the sea, the countryside, suited Jake's more introverted, sensitive personality. He was starting to recover from events in June, when he'd been taken hostage by Liverpudlian gangsters who were on the run. After all they'd been through as a family, it was the last thing Jake needed, and had done little to build his confidence in the world. He'd received counselling, but still had nightmares about what had happened. Gazing around her bedroom, Laura's mind was momentarily drawn to more mundane things. She noted that there were still a few things to do. The old pine chest of drawers she'd bought with her when she and the kids had relocated was on its last legs. In fact, one of the smaller top drawers wouldn't even close. It had been Sam's sock drawer. She remembered so vividly the jumbled mess of socks that used to live in there and Sam's inability to wear a matching pair. His work socks needed to be some shade of black or grey, but the colours of heels or toes or the slogans were never coordinated. For Sam, it was an amusing eccentricity that he took pride in. He was a uniformed police officer, so his mismatching socks were as rebellious an individual as he could get on a workday. A sudden feeling of loss swept over her. What she would give to have him standing here in his pants and socks, giggling at the slogan on the sole, "If you can read this, bring me the remote and a beer." Laura bit her lip and took a breath. She didn't want to cry, not today. Trying to distract herself from her grief, she resolved to buy a new chest of drawers, one that matched her attempt at some kind of fashionable colour scheme. She'd gone for an olive green accent wall with matching bedding, which she'd seen in some glossy Sunday supplement magazine. Throwing her legs over the side of the bed, she saw both her swimming kit and her work clothes laid out neatly. Well, when she said work clothes, she hadn't actually worn her new charcoal grey trouser suit yet. Feeling a little tremor of nerves, she took another deep breath. Christ, this feels worse than my first day at secondary school, she thought as her stomach tightened. After 3 years away from the police force, Detective Inspector Laura Hart had passed both her physical and psychological North Wales police tests and was deemed fit enough to return to work. Putting on her swimming kit, she glanced at the bedside clock, 6:28 a.m. The sun was about to rise, and it was time to get to the beach. After tiptoeing along the soft carpet of their landing, she went downstairs, through the hallway, and headed for the back door. Elvis, her beautiful caramel and white Bernese mountain dog, looked up with his doleful chestnut eyes and got to his feet. They went outside, and Elvis padded across to a piece of grass which he sniffed noisily. Then he went for a 30-second wee, as he did every time they made this early morning trip to Beaumaris Beach, 3 times a week if possible. Even though autumn had arrived, the morning air was still mild. Smoothing back her blonde hair as she marched down the hill, Laura tied it into a tight ponytail. Elvis trotted by her side in his usual nonchalant manner. Whenever they met other dog walkers, especially those with small yappy dogs, Elvis would take on an arrogant air of superiority. He never barked back. Instead, he'd give the other dogs a withering look as if to say, "What on earth are you doing? I'm 10 times the size of you and could send you flying with a flick of my paw." An elderly woman came striding around the corner and gave Laura a friendly wave. She was holding a rubbish bag and a litter picker stick. Mel Thompson, now in her 70s, had been Laura's English teacher at secondary school. They met at this point on the uneven pathway to the beach at least once or twice a week. "Morning, Laura," Mel chirped as she stopped, slightly out of breath. Her husband, Bob, had died 2 years ago, so she'd thrown herself into community projects, such as keeping Beaumaris Beach free from litter. "Much down there?" Laura asked, pointing to the rubbish bag. "It's pretty clear now the summer's over," Mel explained with a smile. "How are the kids?" "Jake's much better, and Rosie is looking at universities." "Oh, gosh, that does make me feel old," Mel laughed. "I remember the day you came to tell me you'd got into Manchester, and that feels like yesterday." Laura nodded. It still baffled her how she herself could be heading for 50. "Tell me about it." "Well, enjoy your swim," Mel said, "and pop into the shop if you ever fancy a cup of tea and a natter." Mel worked a few days a week at the Cancer Research charity shop in the middle of Beaumaris. "You know what? That sounds like a great idea," Laura said. "See you soon." "Bye, Laura," Mel said as she turned and carried on walking up the hill. Laura strolled on for a few minutes, reminiscing about Mel's brilliant lessons on Death of a Salesman by Arthur Miller for A-level English. She remembered how they'd had to read the play as a class and attempt American accents, much to their amusement. Above her, the dark sky seemed vast and endless. She called it her big sky, which she remembered was a phrase that originated from the inhabitants of Montana to describe the enormity of the sky over the flat Great Plains of that particular state. In her book, it applied as much to Beaumaris as it did to Montana. Gazing across the Menai Strait towards the Welsh mainland, she saw the sun had started to flush the thin clouds a deep flamingo pink. The ragged mountainous ridges of Snowdonia were still colourless, but would soon be washed with a plum created by the light of early morning. It was a stunning landscape to witness first thing, and she reminded herself never to take it for granted. It was the view she'd grown up with, and it grounded her. Laura stopped on the damp sand and stood for a while, just gazing at the view. Recollections of the ghosts of her childhood and those of a more recent past seemed more prevalent than usual. The time her tide, Welsh for grandfather, had taken her and her sister, Emma, to the beach, and they'd used a stick to spell out their names in huge letters on the sand. Then they'd sat and watched until the tide came in and washed them away. Maybe her reassessment of the past was due to the anxiety of returning to the police force. After all, she'd resigned 3 years ago, realising that the trauma of Sam's death had made it impossible for her to do her job properly anymore. "Just get on with it, Laura," she said to herself as she took off her pink Nike hoodie and black trackies so that she was now just wearing her navy swimsuit. When it got really cold, she'd resort to wearing neoprene swimming gloves and a cap. But the water was still relatively warm, 16 degrees Celsius, as it had retained much of the heat from the summer. Resting close to where she'd placed her things was a tangle of beautiful driftwood, which had been smoothed by the sea and then blanched to an exquisite pale grey colour by the sun. Maybe she'd take some back with her, and she and Jake could make some kind of driftwood sculpture at the weekend. With a sudden desire to experience that giddy, icy rush once again, she marched down towards the waves, her toes sinking deeper and deeper into the wet sand. The sea looked so inviting, and before she knew it, she ploughed through the water and dived into an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.